Hello and welcome to the Low Code Podcast. I'm Faroz Khan from iTrack, and we are the global specialist in OutSystems recruitment. With this podcast, our aim is to increase awareness and appreciation of OutSystems and its impact and benefits to the market. And our early adoption is giving competitive edge to businesses worldwide. During our podcast, myself and my colleague Sushil Chauhan will be speaking to IT leaders and OutSystems MVPs on how OutSystems has transformed their businesses and careers. We also hope that by speaking to MVPs on their career journeys, we can inspire developers from all over the world to learn from others who have already been on the path. So let's go. Hello and welcome to the latest episode of the Low Code Podcast. Today, my guest is Daniel Kuhlman from the Netherlands, OutSystems MVP and software development lead at Product League. How are you, Daniel?
Hey, Faroz. Thank you. Yeah, I'm very good. Thank you for having me.
Thank you for being part of the podcast. It's great to have you. You're in the Netherlands at the moment. I see you mentioned in a very nice hotel overseeing with a nice view.
Yeah, indeed. Yeah, we had 2 days in a hotel talking a lot of things on, a lot of changes in the company going on.
And, perfect.
Use a hotel to do that. And I'm having a nice overview of all of Utrecht from the top floor.
That's really nice. Is it a nice day there today or?
Yeah, I think it's a good day to stay in the office. It's a bit
okay.
Of gray.
Yeah, it's not
really sunny.
Yeah. Well, we just tend to, we'll start off with just kind of find out a bit about yourself. A bit about your background, that would be good.
Yeah. Okay, so my name is Daniel Kuhlman. I live in The Hague. That's for people that don't know the Netherlands, that's on the west coast, on the seaside. I live there with my girlfriend. We like to walk on the seaside, as much as possible. I work in Utrecht, which is like a 1 hour commute at Product League as a software development manager. And Product League is an OutSystems partner. Let's start where, how did I get into OutSystems or in software development?
Yeah.
I can start either way, going backwards.
Yeah, it'd be good to start from the beginning, how you chose the career you chose. And...
Yeah. So, well, the real beginning is that I started learning coding when I was 10. Wow. My father was building a computer, and that's how I got in touch with computers. And when I was about 15, 16, he started a computer shop. That was in the time that in end of the 70s, begin 80s, when the IBM PC came and, small companies would start using a computer to do their bookkeeping. And so he had a shop there and I was helping out. I was studying totally different things. And, I like to do, work with computers.
Yeah.
Not just programming, but just installing software, helping people. And that's kind of how I rolled into IT.
Yeah.
And I started to look for some schooling to be a developer. And at that time, there were not that many options. So, I could get a COBOL developer. That was like the only thing I could find at that time. And I enrolled in that program. That was like a half year ramp up to be a COBOL programmer and then have a traineeship at the customer at the company. And that's how I started my IT career. Pretty early, I think I was not even 18 when I started professionally programming.
Wow.
So I was like the baby programmer at that company. Yeah, yeah. Everybody was like 30 or older.
Yeah, you're the young guy coming along.
Yeah, the young guy. And now I'm the old guy.
At least at one point you could say you were the young guy.
Yeah, from day one, actually in my traineeship there, I needed to code a program generator. So it actually was even written in COBOL to generate some COBOL code. So, you're taking that fast forward to OutSystems, they do it like on large scale. It's a program generator in the end. And I think that was like a red line through my whole career to always look at, how can we automate the programming? How can we, cut away the boring tasks? How can we speed up the development? It has never been my interest to, to dive, to in the code or in the machine and understand the machine. It's always about, I need to fix a problem and I want to do it as fast as possible.
As quick as possible, yeah. Gotcha.
Yeah. So, I did a lot of stuff. I think somewhere halfway through my career, it was the Microsoft stack.
Mm-hmm.
And from there up to OutSystems, I was doing like everything around Microsoft. And over the years, they had a lot of technology. I used to do Visual Basic in the beginning. Later, it was C#. And, then is the Azure stuff, and a lot of technology. And then in the end, I think 2008, I got introduced to OutSystems. I was working at a company as a contractor, and I was part of a meeting. They showed OutSystems, and I was like, well, I don't know what it is, but that doesn't sound something where you can build software with.
Yeah, sure.
And I kind of, you know, it was that meeting, and I didn't pay attention to it until 2015.
Wow, long time.
I came again across my path again. Yeah. And I think by that time, it was more mature, and also on the documentation available for yourself to dive into it and learn more about it. And I did. And I think I instantly fell in love with it.
Yeah.
Because it was so simple. Yeah. It was so simple to understand, and full stack, front end, back end, all in one. Very opinionated. So you don't have like 10, 20 options to do something. You know, there's one way to do it fast. And then you can do it also maybe less fast, but you know, anything that's not, it's still possible.
Yeah.
So that's what I really like. It's simple. And that makes it easy for people to learn and start using it.
So when it came in front of you again in 2015, what kind of steps did you take to kind of move into the direction?
Yeah, actually, it took about 2 years before I started having a professional career. So I was working as a contractor for a long time and, you know, building up a career over the years, you know. And so you get hired for what you know, not for what you like to learn.
That's
the thing. So you need to find the opportunity, and you need to be have a bit of a luck. So in 2016, an ex-colleague of mine from years way back contacted me like, hey, I see you're on the community, and you know, you're doing something with OutSystems. So, and we started talking, and he started a small OutSystems partner company in the Netherlands. And he said, well, maybe you want to join me. And he knew me from way back. So you know what he would, you know.
He knows what you can do, yeah.
Yeah, so he knew I didn't know it, but he also knew I would be very quickly brought
up to speed on it.
Exactly.
Yeah, yeah.
So, and then, we worked it out. And then somewhere 2017, I started working at Isengard Solution. It was a small OutSystems partner in the Netherlands. And we grew with a few guys that know about software development in general and about OutSystems, and taking a lot of people on board, not having an IT background, fresh from university.
Wow.
You know, they study whatever kind of science, but don't find a job in it or don't want to.
Yeah.
And look for, you know, a cool way to start a career. And IT is one of them.
Sure.
So we onboarded a lot of people with no IT background. And we had one rule: after, in your probation period of 1 month, you need to have your first certificate. And at that time, there was not yet reactive. It was the
traditional social developer. Sure.
It was like the deal. You fix that, and then you get a contract.
Yeah.
And we gave them proper training. And I think that worked out pretty cool at that time. You know, you saw people to be very fast, to be able to work in a project and deliver good work. So I think that's a pretty cool part of OutSystems.
You know, that is really good.
It's not only about fast coding. It's also about learning it fast, you know, the ramp-up period for somebody to be useful in a project is short.
Yeah, and I think it also, like you said, these guys didn't have IT backgrounds and they still managed to pick it up and, you know, learn it.
Of course. So I sometimes say it's like the developer 2.0, you know, and obviously along the road, they learn about HTML, CSS and JavaScript. Less quicker, or maybe less people will learn more about C# to extend OutSystems. But they can deliver a lot of things and don't need all the other things. It doesn't mean that all the high tech knowledge, high code knowledge and other stuff that people have isn't valuable. That's definitely adds value to your company or to your project to have that knowledge there. But not everybody needs to have that.
Yeah, sure. And when you were hiring these kind of graduates, did you have like, were they all non-IT or were there some IT kind of people?
Well, yeah, so most of them did some things like data analytics as part of their study.
Yeah.
They did a bit of coding, but that's still, you know, that's like the basics. Very little, but none of them did anything about low code.
And was this in around 2017, 18, is it?
2017, 18, okay. Yes. And then 2019, we joined a bigger company, did some bigger projects, and, you know, it grew faster.
Yeah, sure.
Somewhere along the time, I decided to make a move, and, you know, for me, it wasn't a fit.
Yeah, sure.
You know, I think they do great things, but for me, it didn't work out that much more. And I got in contact with Miguel Melo at yeah. Product. And that was an easy talk. And
Yeah, sure.
And the rest is history.
Yeah. And, you know, at that time, you know, when you've kind of first moved into it, how was kind of OutSystems in the Netherlands, its presence? Because in some countries it's quite, you know,
settled. I think I joined when it started. So I joined around the time when also was the next step in the Netherlands.
Yes.
Which for me was a really great event. I've been in Microsoft events and it's like all male and it's very techy and you know, there's a certain vibe, but going to the next step in 2017 in the Netherlands, that was like a totally different experience.
Yeah.
It's awesome. And so it was already really, for me, I was like, okay, this is like bigger than I thought.
I thought
I found something that I like, but that next step 2017 was for me, okay, this is, there's a big potential. And I think every next step since then, like the 2018, 19, I think they doubled.
It's bigger.
That attended. So I think in the Netherlands, it's really, it's big.
Not as big as my road, but it's
Portugal and the Netherlands.
In Europe,
Other areas like the APEC countries are coming up, you know, and
Singapore's got a big kind of
and India outsystem. Because you have high population, so by nature also a lot of IT people.
It was quite disappointing for us because we went to attend Next Step last year in the Netherlands, and we had everything ready to go, and then you know it ended up being virtual, so it was a bit disappointing. But we look forward.
It's a different vibe.
I think this year is going to be virtual as well.
Again. In November, hopefully, let's hope for next year.
Exactly. And, you know, the reason I asked about the, you know, kind of how things were in OutSystems in the Netherlands was, do you find even now, you know, you're elite, so you obviously speak to candidates all the time. Do you kind of find that there's more non-OutSystems developers out there who have heard of OutSystems in Netherlands? Like, is there more of a presence?
I think so. I think, you know, the news is, low-code is all over the news. Because it's not only OutSystems. You see Microsoft, Amazon, Google to a little lesser extent.
Yeah.
And other, you know, everybody calls whatever they do now low-code or no-code. You know, it's popular to jump on this bandwagon. So there's a lot of notion, you know, a lot of in the news, you know, in the IT news. So I would say people know about it. And people will have an opinion about it without knowing it really, you know, like, you know, this is still fun stuff. For the non-critical stuff, or it's not enterprise ready. And but I would just say then we'll just try it out. You know, there's no reason to try it out. It's for free to try out.
And all the trainings on the website as well, isn't it?
Yeah, it's the tool you can try out for free. The training is for free. So there's really not a reason to get a real opinion by trying it out rather than just have an opinion without looking at it. I'm always interested in new stuff. I also look at the other technologies. You know, you cannot do everything, of course, but you can be interested and try to understand, you know, what the position is in the market, and see what you can do with it. But yeah, there are people that will, you know, always love to stick to C#, or what else, C++ or whatever, or Java. And that's cool. You know, there's enough work to do.
There's enough positions out there to cover them.
And honestly, I also like to do some high code now and then, but that's like, you know, hobby.
Yeah, okay. Professionally. Just to keep the skills up to date as well. It's always good.
Exactly. Yeah. You need to.
And because obviously you started OutSystems a lot later, even though you heard of it a long time ago. So you became from someone who started working with OutSystems, you became an MVP quite fast in that kind of process. Yeah. How did that kind of
So how did that happen? Yeah. So I'm like a person that likes to do self-study. You know, I don't put me in a class with people. I just like to go in my own pace.
Yeah.
look for the things that I like. You know, I'll tend to watch your videos like in 1.5 or 2-point speed because it's going too slow. And you cannot do that in a classroom setting.
Yeah, sure.
So I started learning it, and I'm also the geek that in the past would like read the manual, you know, from first to the last page. Wow. So I go through everything. But that's how you learn fast.
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
And but then I use the forum. I noticed quickly that the community, yes, is really live and active. Yeah. And I dropped questions there. I got answers. And then I thought, well, okay, it's also a way to learn the platform and learn areas where you don't have your direct interest by trying to help somebody. Mm-hmm. So that's what I actually started doing. I tried to help people, and I picked out the questions where, you know, obviously if I knew the answer, I would just drop the answer.
Yeah, sure.
But most of the time I wasn't that knowledgeable yet.
Sure.
I would look like for, okay, this seems to be an interesting thing. Let me see if I can understand the problem and if I have a solution.
Have the solution, yeah.
So it's like a win-win. I learned something and the other person learned something. Sure. That's how I started doing it. And you know, that helped me to learn quicker, more, mm-hmm, than just doing my work. And that's how it started, and that worked out good. And yeah, it's also, you know, maybe due to where you are like in your career, I like to help.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah.
It's also in our company. I like to be the man, I'm not like the line manager that tells you what to do.
Yeah,
more like you have a problem, I try to help you and fix it for you.
Try and kind of mentor and support. Yeah, that's great. Yeah, because the community is obviously a really big advantage for OutSystems, I think. And it's good that there's people. Awesome. There's good there's people like you who enjoy it so much that you're willing to kind of put your time in there to help others.
Yeah, and it's only not me. It's a lot of people, and it's not even. It doesn't even stop with the MVPs or the champions. There's like people just doing this, and you know.
And you know, from when you've used it, I know obviously it's forever kind of evolving, and there's new things coming up all the time. Not sure if you remember much of 2008 compared to 2015, but do you kind of know like what version was it at 2008? And
be honest, I don't know, because I had this like this one presentation. I thought like, what the?
And you weren't that bothered.
Yeah, it didn't resonate at that time.
So,
and when I think, so when I started working, I started actually with version 10. So that's not even that long ago.
Yeah,
it's not long ago. When I tried it out in 2015, I think that was then 8 or 9, I don't know.
To
be honest, I don't know anymore.
And at that time when you kind of thought, okay, yeah, I like it, what was your kind of, was there anything, any particular features? Was it mainly because obviously the front end, back end and aspect of it?
No, I think it's for me, I think so, you know, why our system, it depends on, you know, where if it's for, from the perspective of a company or whatever. But for me personally as a developer, I still think I'm a developer, although my title doesn't say it.
Yeah,
anymore.
Sure.
Is the experience, the developer experience. You know, I had no problem finding in this tool everything I needed instantly. It does it fast and easy. It does, you know, just the typing that it, you know, suggests stuff. You know, so my initial period was like, okay, I have to do this. Oh, wait, what? It already happened. You know, this experience, like, you know, stuff happening while you think you have to do it yourself. I think that was the thing for me.
Yeah.
I had projects that I did high code that I translated to learn OutSystems in OutSystems. And, you know, it was amazing how fast I could do that.
Mm.
The experience is awesome. Debugging a mobile application connected to your device, even with an iPhone, you know, things were for me so much more easier than what I was used to.
Yeah.
I really liked it.
And did you, you know, I don't know if you're involved in any of these processes, but, you know, since you've been kind of working with it, have you been in any situations where you or the company are pitching for a customer who is obviously looking at non-low-code and low-code solutions, and kind of how did that go?
Yeah, I've been in one big PUC to prove that we could do solve a big data processing problem. So processing massive amount of data fast and scalable without changing the application architecture. And where we started that with architects on the company side, IT architects, very critical, And I think, you know, not even halfway through the POC, they already like turned around 180 degrees.
Wow.
Have them on board. But you always have people that are critical, but it's, I think most of the time, based on the fact of lacking knowledge, you know, and when you start talking to them and show stuff and have a discussion, you know, it's not that difficult to turn people around.
Yeah.
And obviously Odd Sisters is not for everything. I wouldn't think you want to make a 3D shooter game with it, you know.
Yeah, sure.
You know, it's for enterprise applications. Yeah, That's what it's meant for.
Yeah.
And so it's not, it doesn't fit every problem that you want to fix.
Mm.
But for what it is intended for, I think it's too difficult to explain it to people.
Yeah. And have you found since the pandemic, there's been a bigger need for low code and out systems and, you know, requirements from customers?
Well, yes. So at Product League, where I work now, definitely have a lot of retailers as customers. So, you know, and food retailers. So these companies didn't slow down in the pandemic.
Yeah. They got busier.
We as a company grew during this period a lot.
Yeah.
But there's definitely different other branches of within IT or other companies that have problems during this period. Not us.
Yeah, that's good. That's great. Yeah, we found, you know, during the pandemic, there was a lot of customers looking for developers, you know, globally. And obviously,
well, we already were looking for them before.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. It's just, you know, there's a forever need and there's a shortage everywhere. You know, in regards to the platform itself, since you've been kind of using it, what has been your kind of, you know, your personal, you know, kind of key things you think they've released that for you, you thought, oh, yeah, that's great. That's really good.
Well, so in the period that I really started with it, they released mobile. I think that was awesome.
Mm.
So for me, that's was a big thing. The builders that they are, really, you know, where they
that
started
the workflow
with,
builder and
So I see why this is done.
Mm.
But you know, they fit a specific purpose that's not fitting in the work we do right now. Yeah. So, but I can understand that there are companies where this fits and works. So I fully understand that it makes sense to do this. You know, there's this no code movement also, and you want to embrace that somehow, but also be able to move from no code to low code.
Yeah.
And that's where the builders, you know, where the builders are made for. So I fully understand that, but yeah, it's not something that we work on really actively.
Yeah.
So Reactive Web, of course, makes building web applications easier. So that, I think it's a good step forward, but it also comes with new challenges, you know, mostly about security, because you know, a lot of the logic is client side.
Yeah.
But definitely it's you know, the way to move forward. For me, it's more important. It's not about all the new things that they introduce. It's more about that whatever we build now, or what that we built a few years ago, or people even, you know, long before I started with our system, building version 8, 7, or 5, can still work automatically or with minor changes in the latest version. So the investment you do in this application that you built and in the training and knowledge that you need to achieve to build application with us, it stays valuable much longer than high technology. For example, with Microsoft, I know that at a company I worked, I had like 5 different virtual studio instances just to support all the different types of technology that were not supported in the latest version anymore.
Yeah.
And so the technology changes there like every 3-4 years, there's like the new big thing, like now everybody needs to use this. And then 3 years later, it's discontinued and you need to learn something else. From a personal perspective, to learn all these new technology, you know, you need to relearn. Yeah. Otherwise, if you don't do, you put yourself out of the market. From the company perspective, to invest and reinvest again and again to keep your application portfolio up and running, it's also a challenge.
Yeah,
I think without systems, abstracting all the platform the generated code into a local model, you know, helps there, because I'm less depending on, you know, relearning a complete new language every 3 years. And I'm less depending on our systems deciding to move away from the stack underneath that they generate to something else. So yeah, I think that's the big benefit that I see for me and for companies that need need to use our systems.
That's great. And you know, one thing I like to ask everybody is kind of, you know, for someone who at one point was skeptical, what would kind of be your message to developers out there, or even non-developers who are thinking about low code and out systems? What would be your kind of message to them about, you know, giving it a go?
Yeah, well, you know what, if time is not a limitation for you, you should not have an excuse to try it out. You know, just try it out. You can pretty quickly make a real opinion about it, what you think it is. And I would say for people that have no IT background, you have interest in becoming a software developer, it's a really fun way to start. You know, you don't need like a year or more ramp up to become a very proficient developer. Yeah, it can go faster. So, and there's lots of opportunities. We're looking for these people.
Yeah, definitely.
And for the people that have experience. So I think what I noticed, and we did training and coaching people to come from Oracle developer, become an out system developer. So I think there it's really about motivation and opportunity. So the motivation is, are you interested in becoming an out systems developer? Or is it because, you know, your boss tells you, hey, I don't have that much Oracle work, and we see this local thing as important. I want you to become this. So it's about choices there. You know, do you have a choice? Is it your personal choice? Because if it's an instinctive motivation, yeah, I think it's not a problem if you have a long career in high code to become an out system developer. I did it myself too. You know, it's, you know, if you like to learn new stuff and you're open to it and you want to, you know, don't try to high code in low code. You know, that's a bad pattern that you sometimes see, that you stick to what you know and try to mimic it. And that's like a struggle people then sometimes have. So if you can, you know, forget about what you knew and just start learning something.
Start fresh, new. Yeah.
Yeah, and then you need the opportunity, of course. I struggle with it for a few years to find an opportunity. You know, because the boss says they can do, you know, I would say seize the opportunity. Embrace it. You know, and if it's nothing, you still have your experience as a high code, right?
Exactly, I think a lot of people... and I think a lot of people I noticed in the kind of first 3 months of the pandemic, lots of people on LinkedIn were getting certified because they had a bit more time to...
learn. Because the certification was for free for
them. Yeah, that's true. Yes, it was.
If your boss is not paying it, then that's definitely...
It's a good thing. Kind of a final question I wanted to ask you was, when you switched, because you've obviously worked for other companies, you've been a contractor, you know, you've worked on other technology. When you switched over to OutSystems and your ex-colleagues or anybody saw that, did anybody kind of say, oh, look, you know, what's this and what do you think? Like, was there anyone that kind of joined with you or decided you kind of guided to that?
No, I think, not a lot of people kind of understand these things. It was, so I was, even though I was doing high code stuff, I did work with tools that, you know, that would generate code. I worked a lot with product configurators, so software by which you can easily make like a product configurator. So they were generating code already. So so if I explain to them, like, you know, low code is just an development environment which generates code, you know, it's pretty easy to explain to them what it does. Any developer knows what is a code generator. People understand it. People are interested. They are surprised, you know, you can have it, you know, make a career and a living with it. And even more surprised if I tell them how fast we are growing. This is big business. People are surprised by that. But
There's definitely a greater awareness now.
It's getting more common and common, I would say.
Amazing. Well, thank you for your time, Daniel. It was great to talk to you.
Thank you for your time.
It was really useful. And look forward to maybe catching up in the Netherlands one day at the next step, hopefully.
Yeah, that would be awesome. I cannot wait for a real event.
It'll be great. I'm assuming they're going to always have them in the Netherlands for the European ones.
I don't know if it always was in the Netherlands, you know.
I think the last one was, I don't know before that, but I think the last one was in Netherlands, wasn't it?
And then, the last few ones were, they were also like in other countries.
I think
in Lisbon and in the States. Yeah, and
the States for different regions. Yeah. Our plan is to hopefully attend them all at one point. So let's see. Great. Well, thank you for your time, Daniel, and we'll catch up soon.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, thank you. Thank you for listening to the latest episode of the Low Code Podcast, hosted by iTrack, Global Outsystems Recruitment Specialist. Be sure to subscribe and see you next time.